seeking clarification as a board member of Magenta Homes on agenda item 5. Passing reference in paragraph 3.5 to Magenta Housing, where I'm a board member of. I don't know whether that would be a personal interest or a pension issue interest. I think it sale applies to council students and things like that.
Some of my peers and other authorities.
to CSG in October. I also sent a copy to Councillor Ahmed at the same time, just so you can see how the person is developing. There's very little difference between the version that CSG saw in October and the one for our meetings. Just a few words about people's policy. On section 8, there's a section about governance, and I can imagine it is a key role for this committee. Partly that's about people exercising their oversight, but it's also there's a role for internal as well, checking the deals, policy about different parts of the organisation. Another new thing that we're bringing in is coming into the recruitment to an annual assessment of obvious management for children and to be applied to this protection. On page 9 of the policy, there's a section about its application. Really, it's about making better decisions, whether those decisions are big strategic ones, tactical ones, or even program operational ones. So to get the most out of this management, it needs to be embedded into the real world business processes, and the policy essentially says that it will be. Just what I'd like to highlight. We already do risk analysis around our business plans. What policy is saying is in the future that it will be improved in actually having strategic risk analysis to inform the priorities of the corporate plan rather than the threats to the delivery of companies itself. Program and partnership management will then be more and more important over time. And the policy says that the business case for any program or partnership should be underpinned by a robust risk analysis. And we use risk information to make sure that the business case is generated by our commission, if we were more public centers and organization, and I'm hoping to do some work with the new commission going forward over the next few years to make sure that we get the risk management principles embedded into the work from the very outset. Talk about risk and decision making, or similar and significant decisions that we're making as an organization now, it's about resource allocation, whether that's increasing or increasing resources. And the policy says that any of those decisions really need to be underpinned by a robust analysis of the risks and benefits of those decisions. And essentially, the game of our decision making process. Getting a good understanding of the risks to a project or an initiative or a program is obviously a broader step. Obviously, things change, the environment changes very quickly, and any analysis can quickly become out of date. So we need to keep changing on top of those and refresh our understanding of the risks on a regular basis. And so on pages 14 and 15, set out what the frequencies of the enemy should be. But highlighting what there in terms of the corporate risk register will be looked at quarterly as it is now actually. Similarly with directorate risk registers, they are and will continue to be looked at every month. Such programs, we've got different programs and we have slightly different governance arrangements, but basically the policy says that no other governance arrangements are, they really should be looked at on a monthly basis. Effective communication is vital in this moment. And on pages 19 to 23, there's a section about risk reporting. this committee is key to the responsibility program. And you know, your role is partly about considering the policy, because that's part of our government's available use. And the policy will come to you every year, whether a fresh policy or a fresh action plan that you can scrutinise. It's also about scrutinising the performance of the policy as well. That's where the work comes in, the internal audit comes in terms of both the audit itself, the risk management framework, but also the adherence to the parts of the organisation to what the policy is. Work on the end of the other statements will highlight improvements that we need to make, and I'll make sure that they're incorporated into the policy work, so you get to see them first. You see what those messages are, and then I'll make sure that they're incorporated into each process of the process. And also, obviously, you can see the general reports on this process. The need to encounter, I'm also inviting, our governance arrangements today will drop the policy for the presentation. But obviously, what have you seen and you have a chance to consider those? There's also their responsibility to actually drive a positive risk culture, making sure that risk management is embedded into all of our processes. And to hold the executive to account to make sure that those arrangements are close. And finally, there needs to be a shield that we understand what the few significant risks to delivering the work and how the appropriate action as well, so that's making sure that we've got appropriate risk register and it's brought down to the past. And in terms of what changes should actually see through the action of the policy, well, probably it's about better risk analysis in directory plans and business cases for complex programs and partnerships. Greater and more regular reporting about risks themselves, but also about the risk management framework. More embedded guidance and training for members themselves, whether that's learning or more formal training, more clear references to risk management in our policies and such. Having risk management policy is great, but it's really the start of the journey, to be honest. There's a lot of other actions that we can the next year or so to bring the vision of policy to our eyes. Once it is adopted, I need to be sure that everybody is affected by it, knows about it. So that's about going out with management teams to tell them about getting it on the intranet and including it in training programs that we're doing. There is only me, and I've got a limited capacity. So the policy unit is just getting director of risk champions. And their role really will be around supporting management teams with the management infrastructure risk registers, helping them with training, creating information that we need for corporate risk register, and also helping initiative and contact with external teams. Policy talks in broad terms about how we rate the level of significance of different risks. But as it says in the report itself, there is a specific piece of work that we've yet to do with the senior leadership, both about articulating our risk appetite, the way that managers can actually use on the front line. I've been asking the cabinet for representatives for that piece of work when I take the documents now. As for the new reporting arrangements, we'll start to see those coming out in the early part of 2014-15. There is a high level view of the risk management process in the policy document, but there is a piece of work about looking at the mechanics of the risk management process, how effective it is, and what improvements we need to make. I'll be doing that in the coming months, and also rolling that out through training mechanisms. Like I said, risk management needs to feature in the policies and strategies, so as we develop new ones, or as we refresh our existing policies and strategies, are we working with colleagues to make sure that risk management features appropriately in those documents as well. In terms of programs, source support and information, I think that we need as an organisation around this account is about programs and projects. So we will also work with the change team as well to look at the risk management arrangements for our programs and making necessary improvements in large initial cost. A big piece of work is about making sure that our people, whether that's members or officers, with the skills and the skills to actually help us deliver the policy. Again, there's only me, so there's a limit to the amount of face-to-face training I can do, but I'll be working with colleagues in OT about what relating this back to some other work I've been involved in over at Mersey Transport, we've done a review of the risk register. And that was a criticism from an external review of the organisation, and did certainly have some problems with the organisation. And what's come out at the end of that exercise is a very different looking corporate risk register. And my question is, what comes first, the change of culture and the policy being adopted by personnel, myself and everybody else in the organisation, and then you end up with a different sort of a different look to the corporate risk register? So I think the timeline for this project is set to complete by 2016, is that, have I read that correctly? Yeah. So what comes first, the chicken or the egg, the adoption of the new culture, the new policy, and then we begin to restructure the corporate risk register. And what may be handy for members is someone keep a hold of what we've got now for the corporate risk register, and then when the exercise is over and development, we do a comparison back to that. If we're not a million miles away from doing things right to go, look at the difference as the one on Mersey Travel. One on Mersey Travel came down from 44, I think, identified issues in the risk register down to 15. What would be considered to be a major risk, and that might be what happens here. But I'm not saying it's like, but there's sort of questions in the field of like,
no, that's actually, I think what you naturally find is that as the policy is rolled out, that the risk registers probably will change. We don't have a huge number on our corporate risk register as it stands, we certainly don't have 40 odd, but we, you know, we do have a significant number, and I think it is difficult as an organization to keep your eye on the ball effectively. A very large number of risks. But I do think the process would be, as we roll out the actual policy and some of the changes that go through, I think you would start to see them working their way through, not just the risk register, but directorate program risk registers as well. And hopefully they will be smarter and more concise as we roll out the policy than that to the
past. That change, by the way, was also identified risks that may have come by the own risk register. Things like protection of data files on people can be considered as the work of Mersey Travel held a lot of information about people strangely that you might not think, and they hadn't identified any risk of protecting that data of individuals. So there's lots of things that are new because the rail's changing by the minute.
Just commenting, really says that very well laid out very clear sort of main what the commitments have in these sort of stuff. So the thing that did quite come through to me from a little bit of mismanagement committee point of view was that yes, you know, there's a process of identifying risks and micro occurrences of that takes action and impact on the organisation. And then put in place the control measures that we do and that from time to time. But the other key component is the operating is testing of the control system. I'm not saying it's not in there, but certainly where the section you refer to about how risks are reported, we certainly say for all of the committees, we need the information on the principal risks, what the controls are, and their effectiveness, which is fair enough. But I think it might have been worth a link, if you like, to the controls that are in place and the annual audit plan. Because presumably if we have risks of a certain severity that are identified and we put in place control measures to bring that risk down, then that would be something that the internal audit needs to have account of when it's designing its plan to ensure that the controls aren't bypassable. And I guess by their nature, some controls will be easier to bypass than others, and therefore you get it to, like, you can go a little bit to what is the risk of the control failing, you know, and I guess that's where it's important. It didn't quite come out in the course of the policies of the store, so I'm not saying it's not there, it's certainly there in the sort of description of the roles of the committee, but certainly I think in the role of the audit committee, which is the risks of the control should inform in some way the annual audit plan that you work with.
And I think in practice it does, doesn't it? That's because
it's not an extra two, yeah.
But you have
to find these jobs to be the setting up process, just to be the planning process.
But I think we could make it clear, before it goes to the cabinet more than we did.
I think it's just about the audit principle as we're committing has. We have the blocks on that, which reads very similar to the policy of performance and all of that, you know, so it's almost like the bespoke part of what we're responsible for, isn't it? And how that feeds into the rewards and additional reports that we get.
So the report that you'll get from me in March, that the use of the planning process will be followed, not to have the report
investor. However, the rewards are high.